Good morning. Welcome to worship on this second Sunday of Easter. Christ is risen. Risen indeed. It is a joy to have you here with us this morning. Just a couple of announcements. First, tomorrow, and all of these you can find in your bulletin, so just to highlight a couple of things. Tomorrow, sponsored by Duke Chapel and Duke Divinity School, Time magazine writer Elizabeth Dias, who traveled with the Pope when he was in this country and has written other key articles in Time magazine, will be speaking tomorrow at 12:30 in the Divinity School. You can find more details in your bulletin. Also, we've just heard the chapel choir, but they will be joined next Sunday at 4 p.m. For the spring oratorio for Verdi's Requiem with other choirs from Duke and the community. All of you are invited to that spring performance. Also, a note that's about the communion hymn, which is the Sons and Daughters hymn, just to let you know that we will be singing verses 1, 6 through 9 as we partake of communion. Last but not least, I would like to give a hearty welcome to someone I consider a brother from another mother. Bishop Willimon is here today as our distinguished guest preacher. He served as Dean of the Chapel for 20 years, the second longest tenure of a Dean of the Chapel in the history of this university, and left here to become a United Methodist Bishop of the Northern Alabama Conference. And he currently teaches at the Divinity School and continues to lecture and preach all over the nation and world. So it's a delight to have him here to share God's good news with us. But most of all, God is here. And we have gathered to worship the living God. And so I invite you to stand as we sing our opening hymn.
Thank you. seated. It is our joy this morning to celebrate the sacrament of baptism, our first in Page Auditorium. This morning we are baptizing Charles Benjamin Wolfe. He's the son of Sarah and Michael Wolfe. Sarah and Michael met as undergraduates here at Duke University in the marching band. And with them is their daughter Evie, who is celebrating her birthday today. And the grandparents and grandparents are with them as well. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you to the end of the age. Obeying the word of our Lord Jesus and confident of his promises, we baptize those whom God has called. In baptism, God claims us. God frees us from sin and death, uniting us with Jesus Christ in his death and resurrection. By water and the Spirit, we are made members of the church, the body of Christ, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. As God embraces you within the covenant, I ask you to reject sin, profess your faith in Jesus Christ, and to confess the faith of the church. And so to Michael and Sarah, and grandparents as well, trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its presence in the world? Do you turn to Jesus Christ, accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting his grace and love? Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love?
I will, with God's help.
And I ask the congregation as a whole, all who gathered to witness this baptism, will you confess your faith, believing that God has reached out to us with love and forgiveness? We seek to grow together in faith through worship, study, service, and celebration, to the end that we embody Christ's compassion and holiness. And to the parents, Michael and Sarah, do you intend to raise Charlie in the Christian faith so that he grows in the knowledge and love of God? And again, to the congregation, do you, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture this child by word and deed with love and prayer, encouraging him to know and follow Christ and to be a faithful member of the church? If so, answer, we do. Let us pray. We give you thanks, eternal God, for you nourish and sustain all living things by the gift of water. In the waters of creation, the parting of the seas, and the Jordan River, we have seen you at work. We praise you that Jesus was baptized by John and anointed with your Spirit. By the baptism of his own death and resurrection, Christ set us free from sin and death and opened the way to eternal life. We thank you, O God, for the water of baptism. In it we are buried with Christ in his death. From it we are raised to share in his resurrection. Through it we are reborn by the power of the Holy Spirit. Send your Spirit to move over this water, that it may be a fountain of deliverance and rebirth. Wash away the sin of all who are cleansed by it. Raise them to new life and graft them to the body of Christ. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon them, that they may have the power to do your will and continue forever in the risen life of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
They're not far.
Charles Benjamin, look at this. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you from this day forward. Let us pray. O Lord, uphold this child, Charles, by your Holy Spirit. Give him the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Charles Benjamin Wolfe has now been received into the one holy Catholic Apostolic Church through baptism. God has made him a member of the household of God and a saint together with all who every place call on the name Lord Jesus Christ. Let us welcome him. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you into Christ's church to share with us this ministry, for we are all one in Christ. Let us now stand and share the peace of Christ with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination, printed in your bulletin. Risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts and speak to us now through your holy word. In your name we pray. Amen. The New Testament lesson is from the Acts of the Apostles, the fifth chapter. When they had brought them, they had them stand before the council. The high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name. Yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you are determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, so that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The lesson is from John, the 20th chapter. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. "Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord.
About this time of year, my first year at Duke Chapel, a group of students came to my office, the South Africa Divestment Coalition, and they thanked me for my support of their attempt to get Duke to divest from South Africa. And then they said, "Now, we have a letter that we've been working on to President Sanford, and we want to put forth our case to the administration, but we don't want to overstate it, and we want to be fair, and we want to put our request in the right way. And you preachers are so good at criticizing people when they don't know that they're being criticized, so we'd like you to help us with our letter." And I sat there, me, student activist in the 60s, troublemaker, I sat there with complete contempt for the students. I thought to myself, "You little wimps, when I was your age, we wouldn't have sent some nice letter to the administration. No, we would have taken over the president's house and held his wife hostage and drunk his bourbon and smoked his cigars, and then we were given 10 demands and non-negotiable." And then I thought, wait. I am the administration. And so I said to them, "Well, kids, you know, when you're older, you'll understand, and these things take time, and the president knows more than you do." And that was a day not only that the 60s ended for me, but I found myself on the wrong side of God. Well, it's the Sunday after Easter, and there's trouble afoot. Something is stirring. The authorities get nervous. They declare martial law. It's security code orange. They round up the troublemakers. This Peter, otherwise known as Rocky, to his comrades in the movement, and they say to him, "Shut up about Easter. Shut up about the resurrection." And then they throw him in jail. You got to ask yourself, now, why would the governing authorities get so upset about somebody talking about Easter? I've preached for over four decades, and no politician has ever threatened me with jail because of an Easter sermon. What was happening here? Well, no sooner is in jail, this angel comes and springs him out, and the angel orders him, "Go, preach." And so Peter goes to the temple at dawn. Yeah, that was when Jesus was raised. And he stands there, and he begins again preaching about the resurrection. Well, the authorities move into action, and they say, "Didn't we tell you to shut up about this resurrection commotion?" And then Peter draws himself up to his full height and says, "Hey, we got to obey God, not human authorities." And then Luke says that they decided to kill him. Why would the authorities want to kill somebody for simply talking about Jesus and the resurrection? We all know that religion is just a, It's a personal opinion, and you've got your personal opinions. I got my personal opinions. This is an open, diverse campus. Let's just sit down, and you kind of share your spiritual ideas, and I'll share mine, and hey, we'll shake hands, have a civil conversation, go out and have a beer afterwards. It doesn't make any difference. Why would you want to throw somebody in jail for speaking about Jesus' resurrection? Well, if you don't understand that, this suggests to me that you have probably never been a person in authority or a person with power over others. Well, I have. Let me explain this to you. When you got the burden of power, you have responsibilities. Why do we give others power over us? Why do we have politics? Well, it's to provide the rest of us with some power to secure our lives, preserve the status quo, keep calm, to give us some sense of control over our lives. Politics has become the functional equivalent of God. And politics is the way we protect ourselves from external threats and disruption. In the current presidential run-up to the presidential campaign, oh, the candidates have got some minor differences, but one thing unites them all. They say, I am more potent than this other guy. I will do this with power. I will seal our borders from them. I'll make them pay for the wall. I'm going to give you free college. I will give you healing for nothing. I'll make deals. I'll carpet bomb Syria and maybe Europe. I will punish doctors. I've been governor of Ohio. I will protect women in restrooms in North Carolina. I will keep them away from our ballot box. I have big hands. Well, now we may have to curtail some of your freedoms in order to protect you, in order to give you some control over your future, but you won't mind because we know that you worship protection and security and safety more than you worship other things. Speaking of powerful people, take Dean Powery. He professes over at the Divinity School, as do I. And what this means is he is a gatekeeper. Oh, some starry-eyed, idealistic North Carolina farm boy shows up at the Divinity School and says, oh, God has called me to preach. Well, Dean Powery says, we'll see about that. And then he puts him, makes him read books. He gives him tests, theological and psychological. And it's easy for you lay people to criticize ecclesiastical authorities like me and Dean Powery, but you should thank us. We have preserved you from being the victims of ignorant and uneducated clergy. You ask the dean of the medical school. He will tell you, we can't have uncredentialed, unlicensed people providing health care down in the ghetto for nothing. That would be health care chaos. And that's what the authorities, the governing authorities, said to Peter and the apostles. And what the apostles said back to the governing authorities was, we must obey God rather than you deadbeat, you governing authorities. We're going to keep talking. Nobody can silence us. We're going to keep doing signs and wonders down in the ghetto. Something has happened. The world has been turned upside down. You're not in charge. Because people up at the top, people who sit behind big desks, we think we're in control. Art Pope thinks that just because he owns the governor of North Carolina and the entire legislature, he owns you. That's the kind of the way we think about it. But Acts 5 Acts 5 says that after Easter, the governing authorities tend to be buffoons and the bigwigs, those who want to silence uppity speech, those who function as God. They like to stop locomotion. Maybe they would have gotten away with it if not for Easter. Because the resurrection is not just that God raised, resuscitated back to life a dead body. No, it was that God raised, crucified Jesus. God didn't raise anybody else but a poor, homeless, unemployed rabbi who was tortured to death in public by a consortium of religious and government officials. That's the only person God raised. Crucifixion was the first century Roman equivalent of 20th century North American lynching. It's done for the same purpose, to violently intimidate and shut up the masses who dared to challenge those in authority. It was like in the crucifixion. It wasn't just a dead body coming back to life. It was vindication. It was almost like God saying, you want to know how I think about things? You want to know whose side I'm on? Well, look at the one that I raised. Look how I defeated those who thought they were defeating me, Jesus. It was as if God said, you want to know how I think? Listen to the words and look at the deeds of Jesus. That's me. That's the direction this world is moving. That's my kingdom come, my will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That was resurrection. It's like Luke is saying here that resurrection continues. It continues in these lowly, uneducated men and women that are standing up and challenging the status quo and challenging the power. If you thought resurrection was like a one-time thing happened to Jesus, think again. The same way they treated Jesus, they treat his followers. They entombed Jesus. They, in a vain attempt to shut him up. Then 3 days later, he's loose. He's free. And he's back. He returns to the very same losers that disappointed him the first time. It was in the gospel today. He goes through their locked doors. He breathes on them. He says, peace. And then he says, as I was saying before I was so rudely interrupted by the crucifixion, now go. You go out and you do the same kind of disruptive stuff I did. Do it in my name. And they tried to shut Jesus' people up. But they broke out. And there they are, standing up and speaking out. And listen up, Art Pope. Listen up, all of us who think that kind of we're in control and you don't need God because you got us. After police shot another unarmed black man, alleged evangelist Franklin Graham issued this statement. Listen up, whites, blacks, Latinos, most police shootings can be avoided. It comes down to respect for authority. It comes down to obedience. If a police officer tells you to stop, you stop. If a police officer tells you to lay down face first with your hands behind your back, you lie down face first in the mud with your hands behind. It's as simple as that. Even if you think the police officer is wrong, you obey, because the Bible says submit to governing authorities. Now, I'm busy right now, as you can tell, but I wish one of you would go say to Franklin Graham, hey, you need to read Acts 5. You could easily be on the wrong side of God on this one. And I would say to Franklin Graham, never sign up for one of Dr. Power's courses in the Divinity School, because he would smack you for this kind of biblical interpretation. Back in Birmingham, I had a framed copy of the original mimeographed copy that was sent to all the Birmingham clergy of Martin Luther King's letter from Birmingham jail. And I had it right in the doorway, and I tried to look at it every day, because Martin Luther King wrote letter from Birmingham jail to powerful, liberal, progressive, white men like me. And my predecessor, one of my predecessors is Bishop in Birmingham, had joined with other people in authority, and they had written King, and they said, hey, you got to tone down your rhetoric. You could cause, there could be a lot of trouble, a lot of sweet, innocent people could get hurt if you don't stop talking the way you're talking. And you got to be more patient. And from Birmingham jail, King wrote, people like me. And he said, among other things, there was a time when the church was very powerful. In the time when early Christians rejoiced at being worthy to suffer for what they believed, whenever early Christians entered a town, people in power became disturbed. Oh, but the Christians pressed on in the conviction, quoting today's scripture, that they were called to obey God rather than man. Well, things are different now. The contemporary church is weak. It has an ineffectual voice, an arch defender of the status quo. The power structure of the average community is consoled by the church. It is a sanction for the way things are. Listen up, church. Today's scripture, it's enough to make me ask, I mean, whose side am I on? I, who know what it's like to sit behind a big desk, even though I've got small hands, I've got to ask myself, where would I be? Hey, listen up, people. Easter commotion is not over. It's just started. The same one who was raised from the dead comes to people like us and invites us to join in the commotion. Oh, we have made being Christian so much less interesting and risky than Jesus intends for it to be. Oh, let's join the commotion.
Thank you.
Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal God, whose mercies are fresh every morning, we praise you that the reality and joy and confusion of Easter continues. We give thanks that our risen Lord appeared several times and graciously responded to Thomas, offering what he needed to proclaim my Lord and my God. Open our eyes, O Lord, that we may see signs of your new life around us. Stir in our hearts that you might move us from unbelief to belief. Make us ever mindful of the glories of your resurrection so that we may truly celebrate the new life you offer, not only in this season, but in every day. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you gave great words of comfort when you spoke to your disciples, saying, "Peace be with you." Our world needs your peace. Grant your wisdom to those who strive to provide security, whether it's in a Brussels airport or in a computer lab protecting data. Grant guidance to those who work with refugees that they may respond to overwhelming needs in ways that promote the good for all. Grant your insight to those who find violence the only answer and redirect them to constructive solutions. And Lord, move us to work with you in speaking out for you, siding with you, irrespective of the authorities around us. Lord, in your mercy. Risen Lord, who offers new life, we seek newness in our lives and in our families. For those whose relationships are broken or strained, we seek a renewal of loving kindness. For those whose bodies are weak and ailing, we ask for rehabilitation and health. For those who are tired, stressed, or worn out, we seek revitalization by your grace. For all who struggle to believe your good news, we pray that your Spirit would rekindle faith. Lord, in your mercy. Knowing that God welcomes and hears all our prayers, we offer these petitions in the name of our risen Savior. Amen. This morning, it is our privilege to have with us Ms. Kara Williams, the board president for Walltown Children's Theater, who will now speak to us about the work of the Children's Theater.
Good morning. It is indeed an honor for me to be here today representing Walltown and for us to have been chosen by your congregation to be your Ministry of the Month. Walltown Children's Theater provides artistic instruction, performance opportunities, mentoring opportunities, tutoring for young people ages 6 to whenever they don't feel young anymore. And some of them are really not that young. but you know, it is just amazing to me each time we see a young person come in the doors and watch them blossom. They could come in so shy, not knowing their power, their potential. The arts have such power to inspire people, not only the people that are performing them, but the people that are watching. And we do this for any child, whether they have the ability to pay or not. And so that puts our organization at a disadvantage sometimes. And so when we have an opportunity like this one to be the recipients of your generosity, it really helps. It helps us to provide scholarships to kids that can't afford to be there. It helps to make sure that we maintain our diversity socially, economically, and culturally. And so we just really appreciate, you know, and honor that we're able to be here. We'll use the funds that we receive to help provide those scholarships, and also, on a more practical note, we need a new heating and AC unit, so we'll use some for that too. So just rest assured that anything that you feel moved to give today will be put to excellent use, and most of it will go directly to the children that we serve. So thank you.
All of the undesignated offerings that are received this morning will be given to the Walltown's Children Theater. The chapel supports the arts, not only in our own worship service, which we enjoy each week, but also in the community. So this is our opportunity to support the arts in the community. As God has graciously given to us, let us now give to serve others.
Thank you.
during communion this morning. If you are in need of prayer, there will be ministers in the back lobby ready to pray with you during communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Eternal God, holy and mighty, it is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, and to worship you in every place where your glory abides. You laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They shall perish, but you shall endure. You are always the same, and your years will never end. You made us in your image and called us to be your people. But we turned from you, leaving sin and death to reign. Still, you loved us and sought us. In Christ, your grace defeated death and opened the way to eternal life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the heavenly choirs, and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You sent your only begotten, in whom your fullness dwells, to be for us the way, the truth, and the life. Revealing your love, Jesus taught those who would hear him, healed those who believed in him, received all who sought him, and lifted the burden of their sin. We glorify you for your great power and love at work in Christ. By baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made us a new people by water and the Spirit. We give you thanks that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Take, eat in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ, that we may love as Christ loved. And knowing our own weakness, may we stand with all who stumble. Sharing in his suffering, may we remember all who suffer. Held in his love, may we embrace all whom the world denies. Give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when with the redeemed of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory, through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor are yours, eternal God, now and forever. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive those trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Christ broke open his life that we may have life and have it more abundantly. The table is set and ready. Come, taste, and see that the Lord is good.
Thank you.
Stand. Let us pray. Breathe on us, breath of God. Breathe on us. You have so greatly loved us, long sought us, and mercifully redeemed us. Give us grace that in everything we may yield ourselves, our wills, and our works, one great thanksgiving to you, until the day we cross over the Jordan River and partake of the gospel feast in the promised land where all is joy and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. If you would like to greet Bishop Willimon this morning, please come upstairs to the main quad exit. As you leave this place, remember that Easter continues. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. Amen.